until the current period, or until the last 30 years. It was conventional wisdom, both in science and theology. We're alone in the universe, the whole, the single repository of life, anywhere in the known universe. Well, no one believes that anymore.
In 1961, astronomer and astrophysicist Dr. Frank Drake devised the Drake equation, which calculates the number of worlds with intelligent life capable of technologically communicating with us. According to Drake's own calculations, there are 10,000 communicative civilizations in the Milky Way galaxy. Four decades later, the Drake equation has been greatly expanded on by Dr. Amir Axel, best-selling author and associate professor of mathematics and statistics at Bentley College, Massachusetts. His latest book, Probability One, deals with why there must be intelligent life in the universe.
My calculation of probability one goes far beyond what was explored with Drake's equation. Drake's equation refers only to our galaxy. My calculation goes to the visible universe as a whole, which has billions of galaxies and each containing billions of stars. So if you multiply all these numbers, you get tremendous odds for the existence of life.
I think one of the main changes that has taken place in recent years in astronomers' views of whether or not there might be other civilizations elsewhere in the universe has to do with the fact that we've discovered dozens of other planetary systems around other stars. Now, in most cases, the planets are giant planets like Jupiter, not the kind that would harbor life. But where there are those kinds of planets, there are likely to be other planets too in those solar systems. And so we're optimistic these days about life elsewhere.
What's the nature of the universe we live in? What is our relationship to the larger reality?
I looked it up and all of a sudden there was this, you know, gotta say it, flying saucer.
Didn't even make a sound, not even a sound.
A little bit of swamp light appears here. It goes out, another one appears over here. That goes out.
Billy, Yerko Billy.
And it was just gone.
He said, pussy, very bad.
I saw one, but I don't know what, it just disappeared.
There's nothing to hide.
There's nothing to hide at all.
I was a part of the United States Air Force cover-up for 18 years.
There's no way within the military or within the government of keeping track of something that is classified.
The UFO.
It clearly had a shape to it, and a big shape.
This should be the subject of rigorous scientific investigation and not the subject of rubbishing by tabloid newspapers.
To discuss the so-called flying saucers. The Air Force interest in this problem has been due to our feeling of an obligation to identify and analyze to the best of our ability anything in the air that may have the possibility of threat or menace to the United States. In pursuit of this obligation, since 1947, we have received and analyzed between 1,000 and 2,000 reports. There have been a certain percentage of this volume of reports that have been made by credible observers of relatively incredible things. It is this group of observations that we now are attempting to resolve.
For the last 50 years, 95% of all UFO incidents have been explained in down-to-earth conventional terms. These explanations include misidentified aircraft, weather balloons, atmospheric phenomena, light aberrations, mass hallucinations, hoaxes, and swamp gas. However, these explanations cannot be applied to the remaining 5%. The cumulative evidence in these cases leads towards a possible conclusion that some UFOs are not of Earth origin. In this documentary, we will present unexplained cases from around the world, investigate 50 years of official contradictions and denials, and put forth possible reasons for secrecy. We will examine scientific theories on interstellar travel and discuss the current movement for official disclosure on a subject that has primarily been considered unworthy of serious investigation. The case of the Phoenix Lights began on an evening in March of 1997.
Late breaking. You're watching News 15 at 10.
Do these lights belong to visitors from outer space? Hundreds of people across the valley think it's a distinct possibility. Good evening, I'm Mark Bailey.
And I'm Robin Sewell, thanks for joining us. We start tonight with those strange dots of light that were the talk of the town. Tonight,
as reported, multiple UFOs were sighted throughout the Phoenix Basin. Numerous eyewitnesses were already outside looking up into the night sky to catch a glimpse of the Hale-Bopp comet.
Yeah, everybody was excited about the comet. But in the middle of that, these very mysterious lights appeared over Phoenix, over Maricopa County.
Michael Tanner is part of a team of investigators who received roughly 800 reports from eyewitnesses regarding the Phoenix incident.
Between 8:15 and 8:45, we had enormous craft at varying altitudes come right through the center of the Valley of Phoenix, led by a formation of orbs that were clearly visible through most of the state.
It passed right in front of us, just about right above eye's length. My estimate of the size of the craft from the nose as it passed us where we lived to the end of the left wing that passed in front of us was over 5,000 foot long.
It's coming across the sky, and as it's moving, it's blocking and unblocking the stars. There is actually a shape.
It was actually five lights that were a V, one in front and two on each side, and it was perfect. It was a perfect triangle.
The object we saw, if we opened up a newspaper, you could not block out the object that we saw.
People say, Mike, now you saw a B-2 bomber. My response was, we could land all 40 of our B-2 bombers on the wing of that craft.
If you can picture Camelback Mountain, a well-known landmark in Phoenix, something about four times that size, levitating down the road with lights on it, that'll give you an idea of what this was like.
He says, you're not going to believe what I saw. And I said, yes, I would. I says, that's all that's been on the news all night long is this craft.
The community got pretty excited about it. There was a lot of press and borderline hysteria almost.
Explanations have been tossed about, that they were flares, that there were planes flying in formation. But Mark and Robin, we checked with the FAA today, we checked with Sky Harbor, and we checked with Luke Air Force Base, and there's been no official explanation of those strange bright lights last night.
Truck driver Bill Greiner was driving south on I-17 towards Luke Air Force Base. He witnessed several fighter jets scramble to intercept two UFOs directly overhead.
I pulled my truck alongside the West Silos, which faces Luke Air Force's base. It was like right there. And I was here unloading. Everything was completely quiet. It was like really eerie. There was one right over the base, and then there was another one out toward Wickenburg, and these things were just hovering. They were huge orbs, but it didn't make no sound or nothing. It was just hovering right there over the base. All of a sudden, I hear lot of roaring coming out of Luke Air Force Base, and here there's two fighters coming out, and they had the afterburners on because there were huge flames coming out of the back of these things. Ripped right around the back of me and shot right for those things. Then it disappeared on them and it was just gone.
The military says the lights over Arizona last night were flares, but the people who saw the lights last night say they couldn't have been flares.
In central Phoenix, in what is known as the Sunny Slope area, the Lay family were coming home in the early evening to watch for the Hale-Bopp comet when they witnessed a very large craft fly directly over their house.
You know, because when the craft went over, I really focused on the light. The tip was right out in the street, and the arm is going by, and the end of the arm was at least to that mountain over there. It was 600-700 feet away with these huge lights set inside of it.
And I look inside, and it's like, it's wavy. When you look down the street on a hot day in Phoenix, above the street's like, it's really wavy, and you see everything kind of distorted, and that's what it looked like up inside the middle of the craft.
And it just skimmed by, didn't even make a sound, not even a sound.
Further eyewitness testimony came from Stacy Rhodes and her daughter Emily, who both saw a giant craft fly over their car.
It was gunmetal black. It wasn't shiny, it wasn't invisible, it was more of a dull bluish black color.
And we both just stayed there and looked at it for a couple minutes, and it was completely silent.
Mike Fortson spotted the same craft from his backyard in Chandler, a suburb of Phoenix.
When you're looking to the north towards Phoenix proper, the lights of the city of Phoenix and Tempe and Scottsdale and all these here will form a gray background. And this was a black object coming through a gray background. We had no problem whatsoever seeing this vehicle. We knew it wasn't really ours because it was just too doggone big. Matter of fact, profoundly massive is a better way to describe it. We don't really have words in our language to describe something that large. It was huge.
Councilwoman Frances Barwood was approached by a reporter who complained about the lack of response from local government regarding the sightings.
What this reporter said was that they had gone to every level of government, including the city of Phoenix, and nobody would talk to them. That this object went from north of Prescott, from Paulden, all the way down to Tucson, and then was also seen in Wickenburg. And nobody would give them any answer. They either told them that they were not going to talk about it at all, or that there was nothing, that nothing happened.
Responding to mounting pressure from his constituents, Governor Fife Symington held a press conference.
Oh, I'm going to order a full, you know, investigation of this through DPS. We're going to make all the necessary inquiries, and we're going to get to the bottom of it. We're going to find out if it was a UFO.
Later that day, Governor Symington held an unscheduled live press conference to announce that they had discovered the source behind the Phoenix lights.
Now I'll ask Officer Stein and his colleagues to escort the accused into the room so that we may all look upon the guilty party. Now this just goes to show that you guys are entirely too serious.
Well, I think everybody pretty much laughed at it. I thought it was really disgusting. He was just dismissing everything that these people had seen and said. Just like we're all Looney Tunes. I just thought that was a really improper attitude for somebody in his position.
Nobody in state, local, federal, military, nobody wanted to talk about it. They didn't want to interview witnesses. They said it didn't happen. They said it didn't concern them. There was one councilwoman, Frances Barwood. She's the one that spoke up and said, why don't we investigate? And then when it came time for her election, she lost. And the press, the media, everybody else was really trashing her bad.
Why is everybody so afraid? And the only thing I can think of is, one, they're afraid of their careers, which, you know, comes to a point of what's more important, your soul or your job, and I guess to them it's their job. And the second thing is the scorn factor.
In 2006, we caught up with Governor Fife Symington to find out what really happened and whether he believed the military's explanation that the Phoenix lights were just flares.
I was never satisfied with the explanation that they were high altitude flares. It didn't look like that. They were too, it was all too symmetrical. I mean, it clearly had a shape to it, and a big shape, and it was a constant shape. And you can't control flares that way. There's just no way they were flares.
We also asked him what he wanted to accomplish with his alien stunt at the press conference.
The hysteria that was building with Francis Barwood on the city council and some others, that I thought it was just, they were just getting too, overboard about it. I mean, it was unbelievable, the hysteria that was building. And I just felt that there was a need for some levity. And we were known once in a while to pull a prank. And I dressed my chief of staff up as a Martian. We let him in this Martian costume and handcuffs with the Department of Public Safety police officers. And it was just hilarious. And it was just a total meltdown at the press conference. So it was a spoof.
And now I'll ask Officer Stein and his colleagues to escort the accused into the room so that we may all look upon the guilty party. Don't get him too close to me, please.
We confronted him with a tape recording from one of his many constituents who failed to find the humor in this staged event.
It's been a long time since I've been put on the spot on TV.
Okay. Is this still a matter of ridicule to him after he came out on TV with his alien making us all look a little foolish? We've all remained unwavering on our descriptions. A lot of evidence has been provided since. And I'm wondering if he still feels this is a matter of ridicule or if he has taken a new stance on this.
Well, that's a good question. And of course, as I said earlier, I never felt that the overall situation was a matter of ridicule. We certainly took advantage of it.
Now, this just goes to show that you guys are entirely too serious.
Yeah, if I had to do it all over again, I probably would have handled it differently. But at least I have the opportunity now to correct the record, and that's important.
In correcting the record, he told us what he would say now.
I would say that at that time in over Phoenix, we all experienced a very exciting sighting of some kind of a craft of unknown origin. Nobody's ever been able to explain it, and that it was, most of us feel that it was definitely, of alien origin, enormous, inexplicable, probably one of the major sightings in modern history in the country, because a lot of people saw it in Maricopa County, and I saw it too. And we never got to the bottom of it. We never found out what they were.
The U.S. military's involvement in the UFO subject dates back to World War II. It began with the sighting by Air Force pilots of mysterious luminous orbs called Foo Fighters, which would pace aircraft during missions and then dart away.
They fly circles around anything we've got flying. That strange behavior includes the ability to both hover and move at extremely high velocity, to make right angle turns at high speed, to go straight up, straight down, all of this typically without any noise, without any visible external engine, without any wings, without any tail. We simply could not do that back 50 years ago.
In the summer of 1947, numerous UFOs were spotted by local authorities, airline pilots, and civilians worldwide. By July, these sightings made headlines in newspapers all across the United States, culminating on the 8th of July with the alleged recovery of a crashed disc on a ranch near Roswell, New Mexico. The military were quick to respond.
They send agents out all over this area here to try to get information on Roswell. And yet we stood back like fools and said it didn't exist. It was a weather balloon.
50 years after the incident, Colonel Philip J. Corso, formerly a member of the National Security Council, revealed that the weather balloons over Roswell was a cover story for the crash of an alien craft.
We had the cover to protect our own installation because they tabbed us as kooks and they destroyed our organization. You had to understand what was going on in the government and the climate of opinion, though. So, discretion, better part of valor. We just kept it to ourselves. Only some certain people knew about it. Head to head, brain to brain, no paper trail.
Although the official position claimed that UFOs didn't exist, this secret memorandum written by General Nathan Twining suggests otherwise. The consensus expressed by the Air Materiel Command was that the phenomenon reported is something real and not visionary or fictitious. The memo continues. There are objects, probably approximating the shape of a disc, of such appreciable size as to appear to be as large as a man-made aircraft. In this chaotic climate, and in an effort to reorganize the U.S. military, President Truman passed the National Security Act. This act built the framework for America's modern national security structure. Among other things, the act established the National Security Council and the CIA.
The National Security Act of 1947 allowed for the creation of a state within a state.
Author of UFOs and the National Security State, Richard Dolan, asserts that the signing of the National Security Act created an intelligence infrastructure capable of maintaining a very high level of secrecy.
One with an enormous amount of power, an enormous amount of wealth, an enormous amount of secrecy, and latitude of action.
The level of secrecy imposed by the U.S. government on the UFO issue is revealed in this top-secret memorandum. It was written in 1950 by electronics engineer Wilbert Smith, a high-ranking official in the Canadian Department of Transport. After a meeting with a top government scientist employed by the Pentagon, Smith was informed that flying saucers exist. And more significantly, the matter is the most highly classified subject in the United States government, rating higher even than the H-bomb.
In my opinion, I think they were worried that it would panic the public if they knew that someone had vehicles that had this kind of performance, way back right after World War II.
On a clear night in February of 1951, Lieutenant Graham Bethune sat at the controls of a U.S. Navy transport plane en route from Iceland to America. The flight was routine until Bethune spotted a strange group of lights below his aircraft.
And we were at 10,000 feet. This was about 15 miles away. It came up to us like that, just about that fast. And of course, I disengaged the autopilot to put the nose over. I thought we'd be able to go under this thing and not collide with it. And when I did, it's staring me in the face and you couldn't see anything out the cockpit. We could tell it was a monster about 300 feet in diameter. As it drifted out to our right, we could see the dome.
According to Lieutenant Bethune, the object remained in this position for about a minute. It then accelerated rapidly and disappeared above the horizon. Upon landing at an air base in Newfoundland, he was debriefed and interrogated by several officers from Naval Intelligence. At the conclusion, he was ordered to never speak about this incident again.
You accept anything like that simply because you're in the military and that's your job, is defending the country, and whatever they tell you to do, you do.
The identity of the group responsible for imposing the secrecy around the UFO issue was revealed to Lieutenant Bethune several months later in a conversation with an officer from Naval Intelligence.
And I asked him the question, I said, what happens to this report? Where does it go? He said, it goes to Navy Intelligence, Chief Naval Operations. Then it goes to a Joint Intelligence Committee. Now, of course, later on, I learned that it was MAJIC, which is Majority Agency Joint Intelligence. Now, he said this was a small committee, but this committee determined whether it would affect our national security, that if it did, it would probably never go anywhere else.
One of the main arguments used to deny the possibility of interstellar travel is the question of distance. The closest star, Alpha Centauri, is 4.2 light years away. If astronauts traveled to this star at the speed they reached the moon, it would take them roughly 100,000 years.
Okay, make it smooth.
Another major obstacle in obtaining interstellar travel would be the amount of fuel required.
When you're driving a car, the amount of propellant you have to carry in your fuel tank is very small, just a few percent of the weight of the car. When you're trying to carry enough propellant to take a rocket ship vast distances, even in our solar system, pretty soon you find yourself carrying propellant just to propel the propellant. This problem skyrockets to infinity.
So we'd want to go to propulsive systems that have very, very high exhaust velocities. And with a chemical reaction, essentially a barely contained explosion in a chemical rocket, you have a limit to that. And that limit is currently almost met by the shuttle engines. You can't go beyond it very well. And so we have to go to some other kind of propulsive source.
Even if we could develop a radical form of propulsion capable of obtaining near light speed, Einstein's theory of relativity tells us that we would encounter another enormous problem.
There's a law of relativity that says that the closer you try to accelerate something, like a rocket, to the speed of light, the more massive it becomes. And so it becomes infinitely massive at the speed of light, which makes it impossible to get there.
New way of thinking about the universe.
Physics professor, Rhodes Scholar, and author of the national bestseller, The Elegant Universe, Dr. Brian Greene has been researching relativity and quantum physics for several decades. Dr. Greene brings up another problem with traveling near the speed of light.
If astronauts one day go to the moon and beyond in ships that travel at a substantial fraction of the speed of light, when they return to Earth, relativity really tells us they will be in for a shock. Because while they may have thought a few months went by, they'll get back to Earth and they'll see that years and years, hundreds, perhaps thousands of years, will have gone by. This is not science fiction. This is science fact.
So the idea of traveling between stellar systems in normal space, I don't believe is possible. We're going to have to invoke jump gates from Babylon 5, warp drives from Star Trek. And of course, in the 100 years, who knows what might develop.
Although at present, the solution to interstellar travel may sound like science fiction, a growing number of scientists are exploring radical new theories that may circumvent these obstacles.
We're beginning to discover in theoretical physics that maybe our entire universe is just a subset of a much greater universe, a multidimensional universe, that's being investigated in modern superstring and M-brain theory. In the context of those theories, there may be new possibilities to, so to speak, step outside of space-time, move somewhere else, and come back into our universe at some distant location.
Einstein teaches us that the fabric of space can respond to its environment. It can warp and curve. And in fact, the equations of general relativity allow the fabric of space to have severe bends. So long as you distribute matter and energy in the appropriate way, you can bend space fairly significantly. So in principle, it's possible that if you want to go from one end of the universe to another, you don't have to travel all along the fabric of space. Maybe you can bend the fabric of space and then travel from here to here, very short journey, by a shortcut, a wormhole.
Continuing research into the possibilities of interstellar travel are currently being conducted by NASA's Breakthrough Propulsion Team, headed by Mark Millis.
What we're trying to do is break it down into the smaller steps to attack the critical make-break issues of some of the things we need to find out. Can you propel a vehicle without propellant? Can you conserve momentum in the process? The issues of faster-than-light travel, the causality violations and things like that. Address those in smaller steps to see if you can eventually lead that way.
Today we have scientists working for NASA, working for the U.S. Air Force, working for British Aerospace, working for other firms and agencies that we don't even know about, that are intent on discovering how to do star travel. They have already decided it can be done, theoretically. Now the question is, okay, what's the trick? Let's figure it out.
If you look back 50, 100 years to what sciences we knew then and what we could do today, who knows what we could do in the future.
So I have an inherent optimism about progress. And I think that what seems impossible today will possibly be possible tomorrow.
We're at that point of imagining these things, asking these technological questions. Clearly, that opens the door to at least the possibility that others have figured it out already.
T-minus 15 seconds and counting. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
All right, there it goes.
In 1965, Gordon Cooper was the last American astronaut to go up into space alone.
What they think on it. Now the action that I have taken is to turn off my O5G switch gears and my...
He orbited the planet 22 times.
I think that those of you that know me know that I've always spoken honestly and straightforward to you. I intend to do so today.
10 years earlier, while stationed at Edwards Air Force Base, Cooper witnessed an event that has yet to be explained nearly 50 years later. He was supervising the filming of a precision landing facility for F-86 fighter jets. Suddenly, a saucer-like craft flew directly over the cameraman. Three landing gear apparatus opened, and the object landed on the dry lake bed.
They're just typical saucer shape, double lenticular shape, metallic. And they went out, picked up their cameras, and moved on out toward him filming. And he lifted off, put the gear back in the well, and climbed out at a very high rate of speed and disappeared.
Cooper had the film footage of the strange craft developed. By the time it returned from processing, he had gone up through the ranks to report the incident.
Finally, with the colonel telling me to, when the film arrived at my desk, to put it in the carrier pouch, there would be a courier there at my office by that time already, and they'd arrange for him to fly in our base airplane back to Washington with these films.
Did you watch the film?
We didn't have a chance to run it. I had a chance to hold it up to the window and look at it. It was certainly a good film.
After the developed film was sent by plane to Washington, it was never seen or heard of again.
Did you ever keep in touch with anybody about it or discuss it?
How would I keep in touch with anybody about it? There's no way within the military or within the government of keeping track of something that is classified unless you're directly involved in it, and I was not.
I went into space to learn about the universe we live in, to get new insights, to go beyond the boundaries of our known existence.
Apollo 14 astronaut and sixth man on the moon, Edgar Mitchell, states in his book, The Way of the Explorer, that he's never had firsthand experience with UFOs. However, he has met with credible professionals within two governments who have testified to their own firsthand experiences with close encounters during their official duties.
The only people I know of that claim to have been in that position are former intelligence, military, and government people, and some contractor people, whose official duties in the early days were to investigate this and know about it. Those people were under, at that time, great restrictions and high security clearance that prevented them from telling the general public about it.
What we photographed up there affected me for the rest of my life.
In 1964, former U.S. Air Force Lieutenant Bob Jacobs was in the 1369th Photo Squadron at Vandenberg Air Force Base in California. He was in charge of photo-optical instrumentation at a tracking site in Big Sur, 124 miles away. His mission was to film an Atlas rocket go through all three stages of powered flight. This particular mission was part of the Nike Zeus objective for the development of an anti-missile missile during the height of the Cold War. All cameras rolled as they heard liftoff from Vandenberg over their radio.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
We were looking down south, southwest, and the missile popped up through the fog. It was just beautiful. And our guys on our M45 tracking mount with 180-inch lenses on it got it. And sure enough, we could see all three stages of powered flight as they burned out and dropped away. And then, of course, to our naked eye, all we saw was a smoke trail going off into subspace. So we whoopied and shouted and heard the film wrap off in the BU telescope. And figured, well, that was our first big deal, and we got it.
Lieutenant Jacobs then took the cans of film down to Vandenberg to have them developed that night. The following morning, Jacobs was ordered to go immediately to the office of Major Florence J. Mansman, the ranking optical instrumentation officer in charge.
I walked into his office, and they had a screen and a 16-millimeter projector set up. There was a couch. And Major Mansman said, sit down, and there were two guys, as I recall, two guys in gray suits, civilian clothes. which was fairly unusual. And Major Vansman said, "Watch this," and turned on the film projector. And I watched the screen, and there was the launch from the day or two before it at Big Sur. As the Atlas missile entered the frame, we could see the whole third stage, which has two rocket nozzles like this and one in the center, a gimbaled one in the center, fill in our frame from about 160 miles. That was pretty exciting optics. And then on that telescope, we could see the warhead, the dummy warhead.
According to Jacobs, at this stage, the rocket was traveling between 11 and 14,000 miles per hour when a saucer-shaped craft entered the frame.
It flew into the frame like this, and it shot a beam of light at the warhead. Now, remember, all this stuff is flying at several thousand miles an hour. So this thing fires a beam of light at the warhead, hits it, fires another beam of light, and then flies out the way it came in. And the warhead tumbles out of space. Now when the lights came on, Major Mansman turned around and looked at me and said, "Were you guys screwing around up there?" And I said, "No, sir." And he said, "What was that?" And I said, "It looks to me like we got a UFO."
Nearly two decades later, several letters written by Major Florence J. Mansman were obtained. In one dated March 8, 1983, Major Mansman corroborated Lieutenant Jacobs' story. In the film, the assumption was at that time extraterrestrial. Details would be sketchy and from memory. The shape was classic disc. The center seemed to be a raised bubble.
Now, Major Mansman said to me, after some discussion about it, he said, "You are never to speak of this again. As far as you're concerned, this never happened."
In another letter, Major Mansman describes how two agents took the footage. They did not sign out for all the footage, but took out that part that showed the encounter and returned the rest of the film as a complete package. The one agent stated as he handed me back the film, "That leaves you off the hook, but not off any disclosure. Understood?" Naturally, my answer was, "Yes, sir."
Major Mansman never saw it again. And as far as I'm concerned, or nobody else ever saw it again, certainly not at Vandenberg. I'm certain that it left Vandenberg and went somewhere else.
Another case involving nuclear missiles happened 3 years later at Malmstrom Air Force Base in Montana. This site is the largest missile field in the world.
We simply were told not to talk about it. We did not talk about it to anyone.
As a Strategic Air Command launch controller, Lieutenant Colonel Robert Salas was one of the men responsible for the deployment of nuclear Minuteman missiles.
3, 2, 1, key turn.
These missiles were to be launched as a counterattack in the event of nuclear war. On March 16, 1967, Lieutenant Colonel Salas was on duty when he was contacted by his topside guard, stating that there was an unidentified object above the missile site. Salas ordered the guard to observe and report back on any further development.
Then he called back within a few minutes and was very frightened. I could tell by his voice he was extremely agitated. He said there was an object hovering outside the front gate, a reddish-orange, oval-shaped object, and it just hung there quietly. I went and woke up my commander and told him about the two phone calls. And as I was telling him about the phone calls, our missiles went into no-go condition, one after the other. Well, we lost nearly 20 missiles that morning.
After speaking with his commander, Salas again contacted the topside guard.
The guard said that the UFO had vanished, basically just took off at high speed, was no longer there. These missiles are controlled individually. So if something did happen within the system, the electrical system, let's say, or the command and control system for one missile, one launch facility, it would not affect the others. And in addition, these missiles are separated by miles. So all these things point to the fact that somehow this object was able to disable these missiles.
Later that day, Salas was ordered to report to the Air Force Office of Special Investigations for debriefing by two OSI officers.
And so after we gave him our little debrief, the first thing the OSI guy did is stand up and said, you need to sign these documents not to disclose any of this to anyone ever. And we signed, and basically that was it. Neither one of them asked too many more questions, and we were escorted out.
Several recently declassified documents support Salas's claims of UFO sightings near Malmstrom. This preliminary report, dated the 24th of March, 1967, states that between the hours of 2100 and 0400 Mountain Standard Time, numerous reports were received by Malmstrom Air Force Base agencies of UFO sightings in the Great Falls, Montana area. It goes on further to state that reports of a UFO landing near Belt, Montana were received from several sources, including deputies of Cascade County Sheriff's Office. Another formally classified secret Air Force telex states that the fact that no apparent reason for the loss of 10 missiles can be readily identified is cause for grave concern to this headquarters. In 1993, after Lieutenant Colonel Salas had retired from the Air Force, he tried to gain access to official Air Force records of the incident. In a letter from the Department of the Air Force, he was informed that no UFO report affected national security, making reference to an attached Air Force fact sheet, which states, no UFO reported, investigated, and evaluated by the Air Force has ever given any indication of threat to our national security.
If 20 nuclear missiles going down at the same time UFOs are sighted, nearly 20, is not a national security incident, then I don't know what is.
If unidentified flying objects are capable of disabling our most powerful weapon systems, then understandably the military would not want to reveal any information exposing its vulnerability. This is confirmed in a letter from the Department of the U.S. Air Force, which states, as regards this subject matter, mere existence or non-existence is currently and properly classified per executive order and exempt from mandatory disclosure under the Freedom of Information Act because it would reveal defense capability or lack thereof. This letter was a response to an inquiry made by electronic system technician Lee Graham. At the time, Mr. Graham worked at Aerojet, a prime contractor to the U.S. Air Force in developing DSP satellites. He asked the Foreign Technology Division if the satellite system he worked on could and had detected UFOs.
Perhaps we need some outside universal threat to make.
On five separate occasions, Ronald Reagan made references to an outside alien threat and the unifying effect it would have on us all. One such reference was made in September of 1987 while addressing the United Nations.
I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world. And yet, I ask you, is not an alien force already among us? What could be more alien to the universal aspirations of our peoples than war and the threat of war?
Not every government chooses to deny the existence of UFOs. Since the fall of communism in 1989, information surrounding the subject has become much more accessible in Russia. Cosmonaut Pavel Popovich was one of Russia's earliest cosmonauts. He joins the ranks of an increasing number of military personnel who have testified as to the validity of the UFO phenomenon. Major General Popovich shared with us a sighting he had while flying home from Washington, D.C. with a delegation of scientists.
Ну, почему-то у меня возникло такое желание, я сидел возле иллюминатора, посмотреть в иллюминатор. Я посмотрел, и у меня, значит, глаза вот такие сразу стали. Смотрю рядом, практически где-то, ну, километра, может быть, полтора от нас. И где-то, может быть, километр, может быть, на 1000 метров выше, летит объект. Причем правильной треугольной формы, равнобедренный треугольник, белый-белый, ярко-белый. Ну, я сразу, я летчик, летчик-истребитель, я знаю многие типы летательных аппаратов, но это ни на что не похоже.
The pilots contacted ground control. Ground control did not detect anything on radar, even though the object could be seen by all occupants of the plane.
И он пошел параллельным курсом, но со скоростью, если мы шли где-то примерно там 950 или 1000 километров в час, то он пошел со скоростью примерно где-то 1500 минимум. Потому что он обогнал нас довольно быстро, ну, по истечению где-то, может быть, секунд 30-40, вот так. Он прошел и обогнал нас. И все. И ни академики, никто ничего, абсолютно никто ничего не мог сказать, что это за объект.
Now we're going to meet the head of Special Intelligence Section of the Center for Space Communication of Russia, Major General Vasily Alexeyev. Like CIA, but I don't know how to tell it.
Just outside Moscow is Star City. This is the home of the Russian space program.
Могучий космический корабль унесет меня в далекие просторы Вселенной.
During the space race of the late 50s and early 60s, the Russians also experienced numerous sightings of UFOs. In Star City, we met with General Alexeyev, who spoke with us about the history of unidentified flying objects over Russia.
Все спонтанно предполагали, что это что-то другое. Американцы думали на русских, русские думали на японцев, но где-то в недрах системы, среди умных людей, в общем-то, зрела мысль, и не только зрела, а была конкретная мысль, что здесь что-то другое, с чем нужно будет нам, и американцам, кстати, и русским, серьезно разбираться.
During the Cold War with the Soviet Union, the U-2 spy plane was one of the most highly classified projects. In the late 50s, Gordon Cooper was involved with its research and development. Being familiar with that era's cutting-edge technology, Cooper was certain that the craft he'd seen was not manufactured on this planet.
So I knew that we didn't have any vehicles of that kind, and I was 99 9/10% sure that the Russians didn't have any of that type either.
Я боюсь, что Россия даже в 90-е и 2000-е годы не способна вот что-то такое запускать. А уж о 50-х годах давайте не будем. Мы тогда не на том уровне были. Это, ну, очевидная фантазия.
By the 70s, the Russian military began to take the UFO subject very seriously.
Поток информации достиг, ну, какого-то уровня, будем говорить, кризисного, что ли. Когда уже замечать эту информацию, вернее, не замечать, было невозможно.
At this point, the Soviet Union allocated a great sum of money towards a thorough investigation of the UFO phenomena.
И вот когда эта работа была проведена, она длилась месяцев 8, наверное, вот тогда начали думать, что здесь действительно что-то есть.
After the fall of the Soviet Union, Glasnost brought about a new era of openness. We traveled to Mineral Water, a city near the Chechnyan border, where we met with Deputy Minister of the Interior, Colonel Oprovich. He shared with us a sighting he had while flying in a commercial jet over Russia. He, along with 100 other passengers, noticed a spherical object outside the plane.
Этот шар мог молниеносно исчезать, появляться, зафиксироваться на месте, и как бы ощущалось, что она сопровождает наш самолет. Это длилось порядка около часа. И когда мы уже приземлялись в аэропорту Минеральные воды, только тогда мы потеряли из виду этот предмет.
This sighting led the colonel to do extensive research on UFO incidents throughout Russia.
В бывшем Советском Союзе была закрыта эта тема. Мы просто понаслышке от любителей слышали кое-что, никаких публикаций не было. Ну и что от этого кто выиграл? Никто. Я считаю, что открытость дверей, занятие открыто этим направлением, я считаю, уфологии, оно принесет всем пользу.
Miles north of London is Bentwaters, England. In December of 1980, a United States Air Force base armed with nuclear weapons was reportedly the site of a series of UFO encounters over a three-day period.
There's no doubt about it. There's some type of strange flashing red light ahead.
It's yellow.
I saw a yellow tinge in it too.
Weird.
It appears that he may be moving a little bit this way.
Yes, it's brighter than it has been.
Yellow.
It's coming this way.
It is definitely coming this way.
Responding to reports of a possible downed aircraft, three patrolmen were sent out to Rendlesham Forest to investigate. Airman First Class Edward Cabanzag was one of the security officers present.
That night, we were on Security One, which was in charge of mobile security for the Woodbridge base. And we responded to Jim Burrows' sighting of something out on the edge of the flight line.
Well, the controller on the radio broadcast over the air that go down and check out a possible UFO.
Another security officer present was Airman First Class John Burrows.
So it was like me, it was Peniston, me, and then Cabanzag to my right.
It was apparent that it wasn't an aircraft crash. We knew that much.
Staff Sergeant Jim Peniston was sent down to lead Burrows and Cabanzag to investigate the object.
There was a craft of some sort that was sitting just inside the tree line.
As the three officers approached the alleged crash site, it became obvious that it wasn't what they were prepared for.
Burrows would say to Jim Peniston, "Do you see that? Do you see what's out there at the edge of the trees?"
It was just bright lights, you know, and the only way you can describe it is, I guess you'd call it an object.
At that point in time, three of us had direct observation of the craft.
The closer we would get to it, we would lose communication, you know, with Central Security Control.
Cabanzag was sent back towards the base to help transmit radio communications between the other two officers, who went further to investigate.
The only noise we heard out in the woods was the noise of the animals.
Just as Burrows and I entered the tree line, the shape of the craft was defined. The closer we got, the more the white light dissipated. But what appeared was a triangular craft. When we approached it, it was, measured probably about 9 feet long, maybe 6 feet high, a little higher, maybe 6.5 feet. The lighting emanated from the fabric of the craft, and it would actually move around. I mean, it would move. You'd have different locations where maybe a little blue lighting was going into it, or maybe a little red. And then there must have been some type of lighting underneath of it, because it silhouetted the aircraft itself. What I did that night is I had my notebook with me. I went around and started doing a 360 walk around the area, taking recording, my observations. I was looking underneath the craft like that. I had taken quite detailed notes on that. Type of aircraft still unknown. No apparent landing gear. No sound, but appears to be pulsating somehow.
Yeah, it was pretty nerve-wracking. I mean, there's something there right in front of you. You don't know what it is.
I would go ahead and feel the craft, which was warm. There was static electricity in the air. Very warm to touch, identifying markings are on left front side. As I came around to the one side of the craft, there was etching on the face of me just above the center part of the craft itself. Of course, this is done all freehand as I was walking around the craft, but these symbols ran from left to right across. And then underneath that line of symbols was this, which is triangular, and some type of circle here, some type of circle here, and a larger circle here. And of course, all this was filled in with the etching part of it, like you had etched glass. So those symbols were raised, and they had a different feel than the rest of the fabric of the craft. Liftoff occurred at 2:45, with no sound, no air disturbance, and no other identifying markings. Myself and at that time Burroughs, we were at a fairly good distance, maybe 30 feet away from it, and we had taken a defensive position on that, on the ground.
I mean, it was threatening to me, but it wasn't the type that you were going to shoot on it. And also the fact was that, what would happen if I would have shot at him? What good would it have done?
And then it started moving back in between the trees with absolutely no sound, no air disturbance at all.
Whatever it was went up and shot back up out over the trees, just like it was there and was gone.
Take off, unknown speed, and I write, impossible.
Details of this sighting were first made public when this Air Force memo was obtained through the Freedom of Information Act. It states, the object was described as being triangular in shape, approximately 2 to 3 meters across the base and approximately 2 meters high. It had a red light on top and a bank of blue lights underneath. As the patrolman approached the object, it maneuvered through the trees and disappeared. This Air Force memo was written by Deputy Base Commander Charles Halt. General Gordon Williams, who was commander of the base at the time, denies either seeing or authorizing the release of this memo. In a tape recording presented to General Williams, Airman Burroughs questions how a story of this magnitude could escape his oversight.
How did Colonel Halt's memo go up without you knowing about it and reviewing it and allowing it to happen? Anything that left that base and that significant to a foreign government would have to be cleared by you.
You agree with that?
Yeah, I didn't. Let me ask that last part about that memo.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree. That went under the door and I didn't see it. Now, did he have a motivation in doing that? Did he think that if he brought it into me, I would have stepped on it? I certainly would have looked at it very carefully because it had some things in there that I don't think we were prepared to defend.
Lieutenant Colonel Halt was most likely motivated to write this memo because he too was a witness to a second occurrence, as he himself states at the bottom of the document. Numerous individuals, including the undersigned, witnessed the activities. Signed, Charles I. Halt, Lieutenant Colonel, United States Air Force. He captured the encounter on his pocket tape recorder.
Well, we've got an object about 10 degrees directly south, 10 degrees off the horizon. And the ones in the north are moving. One's moving away from us. Moving out fast. Yeah, we're both heading north.
I believe that he went out there to debunk the whole situation. And I think he got in the middle of a situation he couldn't explain either.
Here he comes from the south. He's coming toward us now.
He came toward us, it stopped overhead, and sent down a beam. Now, the beam wasn't like an ordinary beam of light that radiates out. It was a focus beam like a laser beam that illuminated the ground, a small circle, probably 2 foot or so in diameter.
Now we're observing what appears to be a beam coming down to the ground. This is unreal.
When I gave the tape that I made to my superior, he took and played it to 3rd Air Force, to the commander and the staff, and they all scratched their head, and the answer finally was, it's a British affair, leave it to them, give it back to them. Hence, I wrote the memo that has become public.
I think that Halt was definitely wrong in doing that. Once that cat was out of the bag, you know, I couldn't put Humpty Dumpty back together again, and it lived its own life.
What did happen over a period of 3 days at Bentwaters? Did a UFO actually land at a U.S. airbase in England?
That is one explanation, that it actually happened, as Colonel Holt reported. The other explanation is that it didn't. And in that case, one is bound to assume that Colonel Holt and all his men were hallucinating.
The British Ministry of Defense's position is that nothing that took place at Bentwaters was of any defense interest. This view is criticized by former Chief of the Defense Staff, Admiral Lord Hill Norton.
That the colonel of an American Air Force base in Suffolk and his merry men are hallucinating when there are nuclear-armed aircraft on the base must be of defense interest. If indeed what he says took place did take place, and why on earth should he make it up, then surely the entry of a vehicle from outer space, certainly not man-made, to a defense base in this country also cannot fail to be of defense interest.
The public position of the Ministry of Defense is that UFOs pose no threat to the defense of the realm. Well, I quite understand such statements, and indeed during my tour of duty, I probably wrote statements like that.
From 1992 to 1995, the British government employed Nick Pope to investigate UFO reports. He now differs with their position.
While it's true to say that there's been no overt hostile action, it certainly seems to me premature to say that there is nothing of any defense significance when you don't know what they are.
They claim that something from outside the Earth's atmosphere landed at their Air Force base. They went and stood by it. They inspected it. They photographed it. The following day, they took tests on the weather ground where it had been and found radioactive traces.
One of these trees that faced into the blast, what we assume is a landing site, all out of abrasion.
You're right about the abrasion.
I've never seen a pine tree that's been damaged react that fast.
I've got a bottle to put that in.
Yeah, okay. You got a sample bottle?
Yes, sir.
But when we went back out there in the area the next morning after we got off duty and found areas where something was damaged, that's when you're even more like, what's going on, you know?
I think it's fairly well known that Colonel Holt and his team examined the landing site very carefully, both the damage to the trees and the three indentations found on the forest floor where this metallic craft was seen to land.
Jim went back 2 days later and made plaster casts. You can see the sides. It's approximately 8 to 10 inches across and about 3 inches deep at its maximum point. This is cast number two. He made an impression of all three of the indentations and they were all identical.
The United States Air Force position is that there was a sighting on the base, witnessed by both high-ranking officers and base security police. However, according to the United States Air Force, military personnel mistook a stationary lighthouse for a UFO.
I was told to sign some paperwork stating that what I saw out there was just the beacon that was out there and that there was nothing out of the ordinary.
A 45-minute investigation on the ground with a craft that you're touching and feeling and observing and doing a walk around, to be confused with lights in the sky or a lighthouse, or it's just totally absurd.
Lighthouses don't fly, they don't go up, they don't go back. I mean, you know, and you could say, well, if you were a half a mile away and you thought something moved up and the beacon was thrown, I think we were right on top of whatever was right there. So there's no way that was a lighthouse beacon.
Three competent Air Force guys saw it, told not to ever talk about it.
Georgina Bruni has been researching the Bentwaters incident for over 5 years. Her book, You Can't Tell the People, is the definitive account of this case. In May of 2001, she was one of the first to receive a number of previously classified documents from the Ministry of Defense about the Bentwaters incident. These documents are known as the Rendlesham Files.
In one of the first documents in the file, we have now in black and white that General Gabriel, who was the chief of the United States Air Force in Europe, was handed taped evidence.
Why would General Gabriel, one of the most important members of the U.S. military in Europe, be handed evidence for the incident unless it was of extreme significance?
You had the largest TAC fighter wing in the United States Air Force, okay? Through the British, they released documents admitting that General Gabriel came down and took all the information, and it's proven that the stuff disappeared.
Where do all the reports go? You know, we had General Gabriel out there. We had, who was the top Air Force general in Europe there 3 days later. Why was he there? Well, he's there to manage what was going on. He was there for information control. He was there to obtain evidence. He was there for all that stuff that they're denying happened.
The other significant factor is that this is not ufologists talking here. We have the defense intelligence staff carrying out their own investigation and admitting that the radiation readings were 10 times higher than normal.
One other document released in the Rendlesham files is this defensive press line issued by the MOD instructing the authorities how they should respond to the media. It states that MOD was satisfied that there was nothing of defense interest, and there was no question of any contact with alien beings.
We were told not to talk about it, so we didn't. What we saw out there was definitely unidentifiable.
What I saw did not appear to be man-made. It was way beyond any technology we had at the time and probably even do today.
I could never identify what it was. That's why I've always called it a UFO.
I could say without a doubt, that we're probably not alone.
In the southwest of England, just outside Somerset, there was another sighting. It was captured on videotape.
Got it. Yeah, I think it's coming this way. Yeah. Yeah, I can see it. Is it? It is. That's amazing.
The UFO that you saw originally was spotted approximately about 200 yards to the left of the aerial mast. And I suppose it was probably at about 500 feet up. It was very low in right. The sky.
And this is a radio communications tower?
This is
tower
a radio communications. They've got three military masts on there. And it sends out, one is a navigational signal, which is used for aircraft. The other two aerials are near the top. We're not quite sure, but there is a pulsed frequency that comes from them. The actual UFO, from the time it was first seen by Rod Dickinson, who did the filming, it lasted approximately 12 minutes. So it was quite a long period of time for a daylight sighting to occur.
We took this tape to be analyzed by Lucasfilm's Special Effects Division, Industrial Light and Magic, in San Rafael, California. Here we met with Bill George, an Academy Award-winning visual effects supervisor. Over the last 20 years, his special effects have been featured in films like Star Wars, The Phantom Menace.
The optical zoom certainly would...
He analyzed this footage to determine its authenticity.
But there are several things that I see when the footage is running that tells me this was actually there when this was filmed. First of all, it's the shake.
Okay.
The shake. If you were to give me a background plate of just the sky and say, we want you to take this image of a flying saucer and match it in, that's something that's technically very difficult to do because you would have to match, putting the two elements together, you would have to match the shake. Now, certainly we have computers that can track that, but this is all over the map. A couple other cues that tell me that this is actually there when it was being filmed was that it's going in and out of focus with the background, because the camera is trying to compensate and trying to focus. It probably has some sort of autofocus. So the background is going in and out of focus along with the object. There are these dark things flying through frame, and if someone was to have to put that in there, they would have to composite it in behind the birds. It would be a technical problem.
Bill George couldn't say it was a real UFO, but he could confirm for us that the object was not added in later.
Given those clues, I'm convinced that this object was there when this person was taping.
In 1968, the UFO subject was being debated at the highest levels of government. The debate was triggered by a major sighting over the state of Michigan.
I could see the light on either side. And then the red light was sort of passing a glow over the whole thing, so it looked like
around dip.
When it got to the top of the trees, it stopped. And a blue and a white light come on it.
Good evening.
Walter Cronkite reported the incident on CBS.
Residents of the area saw it. The police saw it. Sergeant Newell Schneider of the Sheriff's Office remembered it well enough to draw it.
What do you think it was?
Well, if they call it a flying saucer, that's what it is.
The Air Force sent its consultant, Alan Hynek, in to review what had been going on. And Hynek, after about 1 or 2 days on the field, had to face a big press conference. He said, well, I don't know what was going on. It may have been marsh gas.
A little bit of swamp light appears here. It goes out. Another one appears over here. That goes out then. But the illusion, as viewed from a distance, is that the objects have moved back and forth.
The public was absolutely furious, and the press kind of made fun of it. And Congressman Ford of Michigan thought that he would take action, and he called for public hearings by the Armed Services Committee.
This matter should be brought
in an exclusive telephone interview. The late President Gerald Ford confirmed his involvement in the investigation.
I undoubtedly wrote Chairman Mendel Rivers of the Committee on Armed Services that such an investigation be taken.
Congress heard testimony from a number of witnesses. Former Marine Corps Major Donald Kehoe asserted that there was far more to UFOs than swamp gas.
In fact, the Air Force at one time had a top secret estimate that these things were interplanetary spaceships.
Today we have over 10,000 cases at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, of which 646 of these remain unidentified.
The Air Force has been accused from time to time of hiding information about UFO. What do you have to say to that, Colonel Taffy?
Well, these charges are absolutely untrue.
The Air Force continued to maintain that it was hiding nothing.
And we've always honored accredited media when they wanted to investigate a given specific sighting.
There's nothing to hide.
There's nothing to hide at all.
Now, this is not an attack on the Air Force spokesman or the project spokesman. They are simply following orders to explain away all UFO sightings as quickly as possible when they become public and deny that UFOs really exist.
So it was pressure from Congress that led to the study. It ended up not being an open study. It was a few days long. It ended up by being a project given to university that lasted 18 months.
In an effort to maintain a neutral investigation, it was assigned to the University of Colorado. The university gathered a team of 11 eminent scientists. They were to analyze and make public their conclusions of the most compelling UFO cases. As reported in a 1968 feature article published by Look magazine, the university study was doomed from the beginning. The project leader, Dr. Edward Condon, appeared to be biased from the start. In February of 1967, he stated, "My attitude right now is that there's nothing to it." He added, "But I'm not supposed to reach a conclusion for another year." The Look article goes on to describe how two scientists were fired over a leaked memo written by one of the project's managers. This memo dictated what the project's conclusions were to be before the project even started. The leaked memo read, "The trick would be, I think, to describe the project so that to the public it would appear a totally objective study, but to the scientific community would present the image of a group of non-believers trying their best to be objective, but having an almost zero expectation of finding a saucer." When Representative J. Edward Rusch read the leaked memo and all the controversy published by Look magazine, he urged Congress to take over the investigation because he challenged the objectivity of the study. His plea was ignored. Left unchecked, the project chairman announced the conclusions to the anxiously waiting press. Dr. Condon stated that nothing has come from the study of UFOs that has added to scientific knowledge.
It is not a fair and accurate summary of the body of the report, which a summary should be.
Three decades later, Dr. Peter Sturrock, an astrophysicist from Stanford University, takes a close look at some of the case studies never mentioned in Condon's summary.
The Condon report is really a complex document. If you're looking for what they thought were wild goose chases, you'll find those. If you're looking to see whether there were any intriguing cases that were really challenges to the staff, you'll find them. And if you want to see whether the staff thought anything was what they call, quotes, a real UFO, you'll find that too. There are two radiovisual cases analyzed by McDonald and Thayer.
In conclusion, although conventional or natural explanations certainly cannot be ruled out, the probability of such seems low in this case, and the probability that at least one genuine UFO was involved appears to be fairly high. Another case summary was that this must remain as one of the most puzzling radar cases on record, and no conclusion is possible at this time.
And there are two photographic cases analyzed by William Hartman, who he thought were possible UFOs.
This is one of the few UFO reports in which all factors investigated, geometric, psychological, and physical, appear to be consistent with the assertion that an extraordinary flying object, silvery, metallic, disc-shaped, tens of meters in diameter, and evidently artificial, flew within sight of two witnesses.
But they do not feature at all in Condon's summary. The part that most people read, the part that the press referred to, were the few pages of recommendations and about one chapter, a short chapter of summary, that were written entirely by Condon.
While the panel of scientists conducted an objective investigation as requested by Congress, the project leader appeared to have ignored the data and asserted that there was nothing to the UFO phenomena. On December 18, 1969, the New York Times quoted Dr. Condon saying it was a bunch of damn nonsense and that he was sorry that he ever got involved with such foolishness. Condon's 30-year-old conclusions are still being used today as a benchmark to prevent further official scientific investigation.
One of the problems with so-called UFO research by debunkers is they ask the wrong question. Their question is, what are UFOs? Really what they're saying is, are all UFOs alien spacecraft? And the answer is, of course, is no. The proper question is, are any?
It was shaped like a saucer. I hate to use those trite terms, but that's what it was shaped like.
I looked up and all of a sudden there was this, you know, gotta say it, flying saucer, kind of looking like it was not particularly far above us.
If you look at that tree limb, it seems to me that when it floated across the road, it was just about that far away.
You saw that it was actually moving, but the fact was it just went, I mean, it was just gone.
Nothing we had at the time could fit the description, size, shape, or performance of this craft.
Orale. Está el foquito prendido. Se ve padrísimo.
It appears that many people in power are being kept out of the loop regarding the UFO phenomena. At the same time, covert operations being conducted by the military-industrial complex seem to have escaped government supervision.
In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex.
In his farewell address to the nation, President Eisenhower cautioned the public about the relationship between the U.S. military and the industrial sector which supplies the military with weaponry and equipment. Eisenhower felt that if gone unchecked, the military-industrial complex would become too powerful.
The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist. We must never let the weight of this combination endanger our liberties or democratic processes.
But I think he was telling us the military-industrial complex will stick you in the back if you are not totally vigilant. And I think he felt like he had not been vigilant. I think he felt like he trusted too many people.
Brigadier General Stephen Lufkin served under President Eisenhower in the White House Army Signaling Agency. He recalls Eisenhower's concern with the military-industrial complex.
He realized that he was losing control. He realized that the phenomenon of whatever it was that we were faced with was not going to be in the best hands, and that those were the, as far as I can remember, that was the expression that was used. It's not going to be in the best hands.
Almost as great as the mystery surrounding the origin of UFOs is the wall of denial encountered even by the most powerful citizens in the land. In October of 1969, President Jimmy Carter, who was then governor of Georgia, had a UFO sighting. He filed a report with the National Investigations Committee on Aerial Phenomena. In the report, he described a sharply outlined, self-luminous object about the size of the moon. It maneuvered silently in front of 10 witnesses. At a recent book tour, we asked President Jimmy Carter about his sighting.
What happened to
the UFO?
I don't really know what happened to it. I saw one, but I don't know what, it just disappeared.
Well, this is a first. The president.
During Jimmy Carter's presidential campaign, he promised to make public what the government knew about UFOs. In an effort to fulfill this promise, President Carter's scientific advisor, Frank Press, wrote a letter requesting that NASA lead the investigations into the UFO phenomena. When news of this pending investigation reached Air Force Colonel Charles Senn, he wrote NASA. In closing, he stated, "I sincerely hope you are successful in preventing a reopening of UFO investigations."
Whatever activity is going on, to the extent that it is a clandestine group, a quasi-government group, a quasi-private group, it is without any type, as far as I can tell, of high-level government oversight. And that is a great concern.
In December of 1977, NASA officially declined President Carter's request, proposing that it take no steps to establish a research activity in this area.
Did you ask when you were president?
Yes, but there's a lot of different answers, and nobody knows, has proof of them.
The American Broadcasting Company and affiliated stations present Headline Edition with Taylor Grant.
The 509th Atomic Bomb Group headquarters at Rockwell, New Mexico, reports that it has received one of the disks which landed on a ranch outside Rockwell. Colonel William Blanchard of the Rockwell Air Base refuses to give details of what the flying disk looks like.
New Mexico Congressman Stephen Schiff was pressed by his constituents into making inquiries regarding the Roswell incident.
I think a number of people getting their information from news stories not in all cases, but in many cases, are not getting all of the information.
In a 1997 radio interview, he recalls what happened when he made inquiries with the Department of Defense.
The first response I got was a bit of a terse response from a colonel in the Air Force. The letter just said, "We've referred your request for information to the National Archives," with really no further explanation. And I found that unusual, at the very least.
After a second attempt with the Department of Defense, Congressman Schiff was again referred to the National Archives.
And I got a response from them that said, we have no information about the Roswell incident. And further, they added a note that said, we've received a great number of requests for information. And I thought to myself, well, I'm not surprised. I mean, if the Defense Department is sending everybody to the National Archives, that they'd be getting a lot of requests. And frankly, I felt this was a runaround. In other words, in my view, the Defense Department sent me to another agency on my request, knowing that agency would not have any information.
Evidently, former director of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover, was also denied access, as he stated in his own handwriting in July of 1947. We must insist upon full access to disks recovered. Hoover continued, the Army grabbed it and wouldn't let the Bureau have it for cursory examination.
We will stand against the forces of...
A more recent inquiry was apparently made by President Bill Clinton.
Let us stand up and talk against it.
He asked Associate Attorney General Webster Hubble to investigate. Webb Hubble and Bill Clinton were old friends. In his book, Friends in High Places, Hubble recalls a special favor that President Clinton made after he first came into office. Webb, he said, if I put you over at Justice, I want you to find out the answers to two questions for me. One, who killed JFK? And two, are there UFOs? He was dead serious. Hubble had looked into both, but wasn't satisfied with the answers he was getting. When we asked Mr. Hubble about this incident, he replied,
was wondering if you, by any chance, recall anything further at this point.
No. No, I put everything in the book that I knew. I'd suggest you contact Mr. Clinton.
We contacted President Bill Clinton and received this letter. It is a response from NASA, stating that no government agency is currently responsible for investigating UFOs, because there is no factual evidence that alien life exists on other planets, or that UFOs are related to aliens.
See, this is what you'd be up against. Who are you going to see? The moment you go see somebody and say, oh, we can't tell you, it's top secret, what are you going to do? You have to walk out. So you see how the government operates? How they can, you say, you should go there and answer. Who are you going to go to? Even with the experience I had being on the top of the government all the years, I couldn't tell you who to go see.
Paris, 1999. The most important UFO study in recent decades is made public. This was presented to the President and Prime Minister of France, urging diplomatic action with the U.S. through the European Union. The report was compiled by the Cometa Group, which investigated over 500 UFO cases from around the world.
This report, which came from a high-level group of French military officers primarily, as well as some scientists, is the most strongly worded pro-UFO document ever written in any language that has been made public by a group of this stature.
The Cometa Group consists of generals and admirals of the French military, as well as top-level scientists, such as André Lebeau, director of CNES, the French equivalent of NASA. General Bernard Nolin, former commander of French Tactical Air Force, and Jean-Claude Ribes, the former director of the observatory at Lyon, France.
The title of the report is UFOs and Defense, What Must We Prepare For? Now it's 92 pages. Text after that title.
The Cometa Group received data collected by numerous scientific agencies. Much of its content was based on reports from military and civilian pilots. This official document was an internal military investigation that was never intended for the general public. The report also contains a selection of photographs. These photos were subjected to scientific analysis in an effort to determine authenticity. Kometa also examined physical evidence, such as plant and soil samples taken from alleged landing sites. One such case occurred on January 8, 1981, in southern France.
There was only a single witness to that event. He was working in his small farm. Late one afternoon, he heard a whistling sound.
He looked up, and just above the trees was this strange craft. It descended and landed 30 feet away in his garden.
La forme, c'était comme si on posait deux assiettes, l'une sur l'autre.
He told his wife about it in the evening, and she thought that he was joking. They went back in the morning to look at the area, and they found traces on the ground. The scientists came out in a week or two, and they took further samples of soils. They also took samples of plants, and the analysis of the soil and plants were very interesting. They were carried out quite professionally, and there was evidence of compression of the soil, and there was a clear evidence of damage to the plants, the kind of injury that could happen because of heating, due to microwaves, for instance. So there was good physical evidence in that case, and moreover, there were two kinds of physical evidence: injury, damage to the soil, and damage to the plants.
Despite the physical evidence, the small town of Trans-en-Provence labeled the farmer as a flying saucer fanatic.
Je peux pas dire que c'était une soucoupe volante, que c'était... J'ai vu quelque chose.
Oui.
Il s'est posé, il est reparti.
A number of cases analyzed by the Kometa Group came from military pilots involved in UFO incidents. One of the most dramatic cases occurred in September of 1976, when a Phantom F-4 jet flown by a pilot from the Iranian Royal Air Force attempted to fire a missile at a UFO. In the same instant, the pilot's fire control console and radio went dead. At this point, a smaller craft emerged from the main UFO and circled around the jet. The pilot then took evasive action and power to his controls returned. He escaped unharmed.
In this report, they say, in effect, UFOs are real. Ergo, the extraterrestrial hypothesis may in some cases be the best or only real answer and cannot be ignored. They are technological. They do things that we probably can't do. And all that being said, this obviously constitutes a major concern for global defense and security.
When the report was completed, it was given to a number of leading French journalists. One of these was Bernard Tunnel, the editor of VSD.
VSD is a French weekly magazine like Time Life. We are a journal press publication. It's not specialized in UFO sightings at all.
The Kometa Group allowed VSD to publish the report, provided it was not manipulated in any way.
If the public was aware of the Kometa report, then the Kometa report was not going to disappear in any kind of official or semi-official dark hole, so to speak. Then the Kometa report became a public fact, and it remains a public fact.
To date, the report has not been officially published outside of France. And so far, only one article, published in the Boston Globe, has appeared in the U.S. press.
I applied a very high standard to the story because of its controversial nature. I was basically retelling what the generals and the other people had concluded in their report. I looked at government documents that dealt with the issue of national security and UFOs, which was what the generals were dealing with in France.
Despite her thoroughness, Leslie Kane encountered much resistance in getting the story published.
I went to many papers, many of whom I published with in the past. People laughed, hung up the phone. The subject matter is ridiculed in the media. And so even though I was dealing with facts in this article, and high-level journalism, they weren't interested because of the subject matter. This was really frustrating because I thought this was an extremely important story, and I know that it was newsworthy.
Most Americans have never heard of it. The group hasn't published an English translation that anybody can get a hold of. And they seem to be on the trail of saying, hey, you Americans, you're holding back technology that you've learned from flying saucers from your allies. So it's a message to the Pentagon, not to the public. They know the Pentagon knows they're real. So it's an important report for what it says. No other report with names, with people, with excellent cases. This is not anonymous reporting now. Has come close to taking as strong a stand that some UFOs are extraterrestrial spacecraft.
In 2007, the French National Space Agency, CNES, released a half century of previously classified UFO reports.
A group calling itself the Disclosure Project is in Washington this week, calling on Congress to hold public hearings on UFOs.
Is there really life on other planets? Some former military and government personnel say they have proof there is.
A group of people who claim they have seen UFOs is calling on Congress to open hearings.
What do members plan to do with their information? They hope Congress and President Bush take notice.
Before a crowd of believers and skeptics, with cameras rolling, members of a group calling itself the Disclosure Project stood up one by one to tell personal experiences involving what they say are UFOs.
I have with me the voice tapes of the controllers that were involved. I have a copy of the original of the video that we took, which is rather interesting. And it's called the UFO Incident. Japan 1648, I believe the number was, it happened on November the 18th, 1986. When it was all done, the CIA, one of the CIA men told the people they were now sworn to secrecy, that this meeting never happened and this event never happened.
We have another. The Disclosure Project was formed by Dr. Stephen Greer in 1993. Since then, he has gathered together over 200 military and civilian witnesses who experienced UFO events during their official duties.
We had ground visual, ground radar, airborne visual, and airborne radar confirmation of some of these sightings.
Witnesses ranged from FAA controllers to military communications specialists.
And I can clearly recall seeing a message that went through my crypto center which said that a UFO had crashed on the island of Spitsbergen, Norway, and the team of scientists were coming to investigate it.
Many witnesses provided official documentation of their event.
Out of the National Archives, I have the 18-page official Navy and Air Force report. So the truth is here. I will testify under oath before Congress that everything that I have said is true.
I think it's time to open the books.
In October of 2002, former White House Chief of Staff John Podesta urged the release of secret government UFO records. He cited the importance to the public of declassifying government documents.
It's time to find out what the truth really is that's out there. We ought to do it really because it's right. We ought to do it because the American people, quite frankly, can handle the truth. And we ought to do it because it's the law.
It's not surprising that government officials of this stature are requesting the release of official UFO information because sightings over major cities persist. In December 2006, a number of United Airlines employees witnessed a disc-shaped craft hovering over Chicago's O'Hare Airport for 2 minutes. The incident was reported in the national media. We'll be right back. Often in reliable UFO cases, the official explanation is more unbelievable than the event itself.
I had the evidence that a crash did happen here.
And then the red light was sort of casting a glow over the whole thing, so it looked like a round disc.
I saw one, but I don't know what, it just disappeared.
People say, Mike, now you saw a B-2 bomber. My response was, we could land all 40 of our B-2 bombers on the wing of that craft.
I would go ahead and feel the craft, which was warm.
There is a serious possibility that we are being visited and have been visited for many years by people from outer space, from other civilizations. That it behoves us, in case some of these people in the future or now should turn hostile, to find out who they are, where they come from, and what they want.
Well, if the accounts are to be believed, yes, there have been ET visitation, there have been crashed craft, there have been material and bodies recovered, and there is some group of people somewhere that may or may not be associated with government at this point, but certainly were at one time, that have this knowledge.
The thing you have to remember is that absolute power corrupts absolutely. When you've got the knowledge and the budget, nobody looking over your shoulder, is a great temptation to think that you know best. Heck with the public, they don't know enough to have a sensible opinion. That's unfortunate.
Я как генерал, вот как военный человек, я понимаю, что любое правительство, понимаете, оно начинает рассматривать с точки зрения вот чего-то для войны, для военного, что-то применить, вот то, что там они принесут это инопланетяне. Вот это категорически неправильно.
I just wish that government entities that are involved in trying to always stop the investigation or put out some flaky story about some observation that was legitimate, I don't know why people just don't stop. And in government, and just sort of, you know, open the books for everybody. We all be included. It's something that we should embrace and not be fearful about. That's how I feel about it.
Since the subject is clearly of great interest to the public, I think that the scientific community owes it to the public to really pay attention to the subject and make a thorough, extensive, and careful investigation, and then share with the public whatever they find.
A story this big, there's no way it could be kept secret from the public. What do you say to someone like that that says that?
Well, somebody's kept it pretty secret for quite a while, haven't they?
If structured craft of unknown origin are penetrating our skies, the people best equipped to know are the military.
And we will provide you with all the information that you need.
Numerous military witnesses are prepared to testify in great detail, but need immunity from their security oaths. Congress is currently being lobbied to provide a platform for such testimony, but so far, to no avail. The discovery that we are being visited by extraterrestrials would be one of the greatest in human history. Such a discovery would profoundly alter the perception of ourselves and our place in the universe.